Thank you. Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining us on the Q4 and FY 2021 earnings conference call of TD Power Systems Limited. We have with us Mr. Nikhil Kumar, Managing Director, Mrs. M.N. Varalakshmi, Chief Financial Officer, and some of their colleagues in the management team on this call. We will begin the call with brief opening remarks from the management, following which we will have the forum open for an interactive Q&A session. Before we begin, I would like to mention that some of the statements made in today's call may be forward-looking in nature and may involve risks and uncertainties. Documents related to the company's financial performance have already been emailed to all of you earlier. I would now like to invite Mr. Nikhil Kumar to make his opening remarks. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Thank you once again for joining us today on our earnings call. I trust all of you would have received our results and investor presentations. Now, let me move on to discuss with you TDPS's financial performance for the year ended 31st March  2021. Standalone. Our full-year total income was 512 crores versus 494 crores the same period previous year. Profit after tax, including comprehensive income, was 17.94 versus a profit of 16.9 crores the same period during the previous year. The previous year included an exceptional income of 2.16 crores from the sale of land. Full-year manufacturing revenue stands at 485 crores versus 455 crores. Exports and deemed exports contributed to 61% of our manufacturing revenues. Manufacturing order book, including our Turkey operations, stands at 1,095 crores, which is 337 crores manufacturing business, 686 crores railway business, and 72 crores from our Turkey operations. Our order inflow statistics. Full year order inflow is as follows. TDPS manufacturing business, India, 470 crores versus last year. Previous year was 468 crores. Turkey, we had an order inflow of 69 crores versus 88 crores in the previous period. Total 539 crores versus 556 crores. Our projects business, our full year projects business revenue stands at 20 crores versus 32 crores same period previous year. Our order book for this business currently is 16 crores. On a consolidated basis, our full year total income, including exceptional items, is 610 crores versus 542 crores for the same period previous year, increase of about 12%. Profit after tax, including comprehensive and exceptional income, is 43.67 crores, including 7.18 crores coming from write-backs of payables from our subsidiary company, DFPS. This is compared to a profit of 28.85 crores from the same period in the previous year. In the previous year, when we had 28.85 crores, we had an exceptional income of 14 crores, which was 2.16 crores from sale of land and 12 crores right back from our payables from our subsidiary DFPS. If I take out the exceptional income from both the years, our profit has increased actually from 14.8 crores to 36.49 crores. Our consolidated order book stands at 1,111 crores, and we continue to maintain a strong cash position of 184 crores. Now, order book, market situation, and guidance. We have a very strong order book for the current year, with including the railway business with Alstom. We have confirmed orders at the moment, as of date, of about 475 crores. We have earlier given a guidance of 550 crores, which is easily possible for us to achieve the strong current demand for our products all over the world. On the export side, we have more than forecast orders in steam turbine and gas engine. We have also been officially approved with the new engine customer that we have been working with for the past 1.5 years. They have made a worldwide announcement about this, and this means that orders will start flowing in. This is a major development for TDPS. On the domestic side, we saw a strong demand from steam turbine manufacturers until end of March, but recently effects from COVID started to be felt. Hydro was expected to be lower, but we got some good orders recently in Q4, and so the overall reduction of our business from the previous year will not be so steep as expected. We have a number of projects also in the pipeline, currently under negotiation, especially on the export side, which will compensate also good business for us next year. We're also very happy to announce that we have won a trial order for about 15 machines for the most popular model of the traction motor from the Indian Railways to be delivered in Q2 in this year. And after that, our intention is to get the full approval by the end of this financial year. Once approved, we can start bidding for all the projects with the Indian Railways and start getting a larger market share. At this point of time, I would like to also mention the difficult environment that we are in with raw materials. All our key raw materials are up 60% to 100% from steel, special steels, and copper. This has affected the cost of generators drastically. It was a good decision the company took last year when we booked a lot of copper and steel when the prices were low, and this has cushioned the impact for us for about 4 to 5 months of this financial year. Other than that, we have also booked euro at very favorable rates compared to the previous year. And in addition to that, we also have price variation clauses on some major contracts that also provides us with some cushion. These three major factors will largely nullify the raw material cost increases for the current order book. But we also have orders in the pipeline, especially those booked by OEM customers and not yet passed on to us. And that's when the story gets a little complicated. We are in intense discussions with our customers on the best way forward, especially with customers that we have a high market share and long-term relationships. There could be an effect on margins to a small extent in Q3 and Q4. If these cost increases persist, ultimately the end customer has to pay for it. But I am of the opinion that inflationary pressures are building up and corrections should happen in the next few months. Of course, I could be wrong also. But our approach is clear. We want to protect the long-term relationships with our customers, but also ensure that we don't lose a great deal of money in the short term. Our approach is also to do what is right to do in the short term and also what is right to do in the medium term and long term to protect our business. Coming to Turkey, we have confirmed business of 8 to 8.5 million euros this financial year, which is around 30% less compared to last year. This I have already indicated in my previous call. The market in Turkey is pretty slow at the moment, since new incentives and policies have still not been officially announced. But we know that once the incentives are announced, the market will bounce back once again. Let me just now move to guidance. For this year, TDPS India manufacturing business, as mentioned earlier, we already have sitting on 475, so 550 earlier guidance is easy for us to do. So we are at this point of time saying 550 crore plus something. We see Q1 to be 125 crore, a little bit lower than what we have earlier forecast. Since lockdowns have definitely affected domestic sales, and these current lockdowns will have an impact also to some extent on manufacturing in this particular quarter. But we don't see this coming down below around 125 crore. We'll have 145 crores in Q2, and H2 will be minimum 290 crores. We will have fairly consistent quarter-to-quarter performance, but as always, Q2 and Q4 will be much stronger compared to Q1 and Q3. TDPS Turkey top line will be around 80 crores plus, depending on the exchange rate. And total manufacturing business will be 630 crores plus, depending on how much more we can do from India. Projects business top line expected to be around 25 crores. All our subsidiaries will be profitable. This brings me to the end of my initial remarks. I will now be happy to address any queries that you may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets when asking a question. Anyone who would like to ask a question, please press star and one. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a more question queue assembled. From the line of Himanshu Upadhyay from PGIM India Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah, congratulations on good set of numbers, and hope the momentum continues. Okay. So my first question was on the domestic market. Okay. Over the last few months, we have seen the commodity companies, the pricing has been better, and some of the companies are trying to hasten the project getting or at the manufacturing stage and all that stuff. And let us suppose the CAPEX cycle really starts in earnest, which has not been there for a long period of time. Do you think the power or captive power plant will be again the driver for you, or you think the waste heat gases would be the driver for you? What is the sense you are getting from the customers, or and your own thought process on what you can do to get some pie or incremental pie on the CAPEX which might happen in the Indian market over next 2 to 3 years? So some thoughts on that would be helpful.
What we are seeing that is that for every greenfield project, there is a captive power plant. Till the cement or steel or sugar or you name it, all industries which require power as a major part of their input cost, all industries are definitely going in for captive power plants. In addition to that, there is waste heat recovery, which is getting to be a bigger and bigger market. There's this garbage incineration plants, which is also a big market. And of course, there's sugar cogen and burning of other biomass materials, which is a smaller part of the business, but definitely it is still there. So the captive power plant business story for India has still not gone away and continues. It will continue to be here. The power situation in the country has not dramatically changed in any way to say that captive power plants are not required anymore. We're not seeing the increase in renewables, which was what people were talking about some time back, but it's not happened. So any company that requires a stable source of power supply will go for a captive power plant.
If I remember, few quarters back we had a similar discussion, and our view was that thermal power plant is a story which is not going to come back that strongly. Okay, but do you think for us, let's say where we are in captive power plant, we can again get back to the similar business what used to be there 7-8 years back if the CAPEX cycle recovers? Should that be the thing what you are trying to see?
Yes, the large thermal power plant business is definitely a declining business. There's no doubt that that business has been dramatically affected. But you know that the bulk capacity, the bulk addition of megawatts into the grid has to take place in some way or the other. So if it's not taking place in renewables, then there's always going to be a power shortage in the country. So I believe that if the CAPEX cycle really picks up, we will get back to where we were 10 years ago.
And globally also, that is the way, means captive power plants remain? You would be looking at...
Globally, we are seeing that captive power plants, we're getting a lot of steam turbine business in export market, like what I mentioned a little bit earlier. But we are seeing that steel plants in Europe, whether steel, paper, cement, everybody has a captive power plant.
despite having very stable grids and having very stable, having surplus power in the overall system, everybody has a captive power plant.
And are you seeing increased inquiry in the current market? Are you seeing the CapEx revival or some hope, or you think
unfortunately, this is a story which is repeating itself for the second time. It was a very, very good situation until, I would say, end of March. And then we had the second wave in India, COVID wave in India, and that has definitely impacted everything. I'm not saying that it is derailed. It is not derailed for sure. But at the moment, I think the people are, there's a slight hold on everything at the moment. We're feeling it, there's a slight hold on everything. And so people are just waiting for the second wave to maybe subside a little bit, and then the business activity will definitely come back in a strong way. At the moment, we are all in the middle of the second wave, and it has definitely impacted the sentiment in the country.
Okay. And this is a slightly longer term question, okay? So in most capital goods, when we see the companies, the innovation, whatever we say, innovation kind of keeps on happening, or the technology keeps on changing. So people need to keep on innovating on different products to... And we had a tough problem where we were concentrated only on very few products when we went into the crisis last time, okay? But let's say 4 or 5 years down the line, okay, what would be the areas where more you would like to explore near our products, okay? And how do you think the company will evolve from here on in 5 years? Let's say more on the product side and your thought process on the products, because what we have seen is too focused on single product. Most of the capital goods companies have at some point of time had issues, or let's say what we are seeing even in case of GAIL and everyone, okay? If your companies have tried to diversify into different products or geographies and all that.
So I think this is a larger issue, it's a larger issue, probably not of an earnings call subject. I definitely appreciate the question. All I can say is that we have a number of new products in the pipeline, and we have built up a lot of products in the past 7 to 8 years, expanding our geographies, expanding our product range, expanding different verticals that we are addressing in the market, and we have a number of new products also in the pipeline. But to talk about the specifics and everything, that is, I think, beyond the scope of the earnings call. So we can have a separate discussion, one-to-one, whenever you want.
Okay, one small suggestion. In the presentation, or at any, if you have the data, you can just share. See, if I want to understand, let's say, in the revenue contribution, the products introduced in last 5 years, what would be the revenue contribution from those products and even geographies? So just to understand how has been our evolutionary strategy. So let's say FY17 X percentage from the products which were in last 5 years, and FY21, how much was the revenue from products introduced in last 5 years? Similarly, geography, so that just you know how fast we are evolving, and because a lot of work has already gone, every quarter we see new segment centered, so just to get some better idea and on this and how the numbers are evolving on the revenue from those contributing areas, it would be helpful.
Understand.
Yes, thank you from my side. Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rohit Balakrishnan from iThought PMS. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi Nikhil. Am I audible?
Hi Rohit. Yes, very much.
Hi. Okay. So Nikhil, congrats on a very good year for TDPS, and also congrats on Caterpillar being an official customer. So just wanted to understand your guidance, what you've taken. So in terms of this customer getting giving us orders, how do you see this see this customer evolve for us in FY22 and beyond? If you can just talk a bit about that.
Yeah, so the announcement has been made. So orders will start flowing in. We have we will give us a firm forecast about this business in the next quarter, Rohit. We are under discussions with them about this very subject.
Okay. Okay. Nikhil, you also talked about winning some trial orders, about 15 machines from Indian Railways. These are directly with Indian Railways, if my understanding is correct, right? These will be over and above with what we have with Alstom.
Yes, these are direct. This is the most fast-moving, most commonly used traction motor by the Indian Railways for their electric locomotives. They buy, as I said, this would be something like a 500, 600 crore business, this product itself, per year. And so we want to get approved. We had the first order, we have to deliver it in Q2. Then there's a 6-month trial on the locomotive. The Indian Railways will, they will conduct the trial. After 6 months of successful running, then we will be officially approved. And then once we are officially approved as a regular vendor, then we get a major, then we start getting a bigger chunk of the overall business automatically.
Got it. So this business will probably start flowing in from next year if everything goes well.
Yeah. Yes.
Understood. Nikhil also wanted to understand in terms of hydro market in Europe. So we've seen some countries sort of beginning to open up. And you said that hydro market is largely a physical market because you need to go there and stuff. So just wanted to understand how do you see that, not for this year, but for next year, how do you see that for FY23? Because the order book will start getting built now.
There are some orders in the European market which we are running after. Let's see whether we're successful or not. We hope we are. But major markets for hydro still continue to be in Southeast Asia and Nepal. So we those are still the major markets, and major demand is coming from this part of the world only. So to some extent, the hydro market is definitely at a lower level compared to pre-COVID, mainly because this kind of business requires travel, requires face-to-face meetings, and especially since travel is really hard right now for Indians in general, it is hard for us to go and meet these customers.
Right. And in the last call, in the last couple of calls, you talked about some sort of capex, some opportunities which you still wanted to sort of wait and see and then talk about. Broader question is on capital allocation, because we have a fair amount of cash. So, between capex and repaying shareholders, what is the thought process at this point of time?
So we are definitely going to grow our business, and we are going to make, we are waiting for some things to come into place. And once those, we expect to use our money to invest in our own business and to make capital investments and to grow our business. So at the moment, we are keeping our money, waiting for those opportunities to fructify.
Sure. And in terms of any other big opportunities like what we have done with this new customer, something similar, anything that you would like to share, maybe we are in some discussions or something is in the pipeline that we're working.
I'm not going to share that right now, Rohit. Of course, we're doing a number of things. We have a number of projects in the pipeline, but it's too early to talk about it.
Fair enough. Thank you, Nikhil. All the very best.
Thank you, Rohit. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ronan Desai from Turtle Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, Nikhil. Hope you and the entire team is doing well. And congratulations for a good year. So, three questions. The first question is, with respect to crisis and the scenario that is evolving that you talked about. Last time when, such situation had come, 2-3 years ago, there was, margin pressure from our side, especially on the gross margin side. So, and you indicated that, we have some price revision clauses with in some contracts, and some OEM contracts are still not covered through that. So, how do you see that in this time, will we be less impacted? One, because the supply side situation has improved in our favor. And secondly, probably, we would have preempted this and included price revision clauses. So how do you see that vis-a-vis last time when such situation had come?
Yeah, I think compared to last time, we are definitely in a stronger position in the market overall. And we have very close relationships with some of these, our relationships have strengthened with many of these OEM customers. So on one hand, it definitely gives us a better chance to talk to them. But it also, on the other hand, there's a high codependency from both sides, which we have to keep in mind looking at the long-term view of the business. And especially, as I said, for orders which are in the pipeline, which they have bid or they have negotiated and won and they're still waiting for contract signing or waiting for advance payment to be made, there is a certain chunk of business which is not yet in our hands and not yet in their hands, but it is finalized. And that is what I'm calling as being the short term problem, that we have to talk to our OEM customers and we have to see what is the best way forward. And we're doing that at the moment. We're doing that, and intense discussions are going on. So I'm not in a position to tell you whether it's what is the result of that. I'm just keeping the market informed that this is the situation. This is the situation where the company is in right now. And as I said earlier, our current order that we have on hand, the 475 crores, is not severely impacted because of the steps that we have earlier taken. So it's really what is going to be coming next from now onwards that we have to discuss and find solutions with our customers. And as I said also, long term, when I say long term, I mean beyond 6 months. Obviously, the entire cost has to be passed to the market. Nobody can take this kind of increases on their heads. So that is also very, very clear, and we will do that. But it is a short term problem that we have to address in a very, I would say, let's just say, holistic way.
Okay, got it.
So I'm not in a position to give you any numbers at this moment.
That's okay. I mean, directionally, we are in a much better position than what we were in, when first things happened last time, is what you were saying. And then, quantitative impact maybe, we'll come to know as you progress in your discussion. So, that's all.
As I said, we're much stronger position, but there's also, as you know, conversely, there's a high level of codependency also from both sides. So, we have to be careful how we go about these things.
Got it. Second question, Nikhil, from all our past conversations, one thing, at least I'm able to infer is that, 750, 800 crore is a sweet spot in terms of capacity utilization, margins, return on capital, everything. So, I mean, from current year, we are expecting around 630, 36-40 crore kind of a business. So how do we see path from that number to 750-800 crore? I'm saying, you know, what are the levers that you think will take us to that number? If you can, you know, if you have any thinking around that, you know, and if you can share it.
I mentioned this in the number of in the past two calls that we have, you know, some big things in the pipeline. One is a major Indian customer that we have now reached a point where we have been officially approved and they have made a worldwide announcement. So that's a big driver of growth. I have not been able to answer Rohit, who had really asked what is the numbers. So, but that is going to be a big driver of growth. The Indian Railways will be a big driver of growth, and we have some other products which are also under in the pipeline. So, it is definitely going to come through new products, new markets, new customers.
Thank you. I would request Mr. Bilton to rejoin the queue for follow-up questions, as there are several others waiting for the turn as well. And we would request participants to please limit your questions to two at a time. The next question is from the line of VP Rajesh from Banyan Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Nikhil, congratulations, and hope all is well at your end and with your team. I just wanted to get your sense on... I hope you get your comments on the ethanol opportunity that...
Sorry to interrupt you, Rajesh. Your voice is breaking up. May I request you to move to a better reception area, please, if you can?
Is it better now?
At the moment, it is. But if you can move to a better reception area, it will be great. Thank you.
Sure. So, Nikhil, I was just asking that your comments on the opportunity that we see with the ethanol plants that all the sugar companies are putting up, if you can just comment on that.
So I have my colleague, head of marketing and sales, Vinay Hegde, with me also on this call. Vinay, would you like to comment on this question?
Pardon me? Can you just repeat that question?
Would you like to comment? Yes. Yes. The question was, how is the ethanol policy of India, how is it resulting in the business of new ethanol power ethanol plants, and what is the impact on the generator and turbine business in India?
Yeah, it is definitely giving us quite a good number of business, because all sugar plants are going for new distilleries. But even though the ratings are small, maybe 3 to 5 megawatt range, but a lot of new plants are coming up, and we are seeing a good traction in this segment.
So do you see it being a growth driver in, let's say, fiscal year 22 or 23 or after that? What's your sense on that? Like, will it become, let's say, 10-20% of our business?
It is not really going to be a growth driver, but it is going to increase the business in the steam turbine segment. Already it is an ongoing business, and the number of plants are going to be more. It's not really a growth driver.
Okay. Great. And my second question is on the CapEx side. What is the CapEx plan for fiscal year 22 and fiscal year 23?
So other than the new projects which we may, if successful, which we may have to invest, which we are not disclosed to the market as yet. Other than that, we have 12 to 15 crore CapEx plan.
I see. But that 12 to 15 is more maintenance type in nature, correct?
It is maintenance. And we, as I said, we are constantly investing in automation.
Right.
So every year we're putting in money into automation. And part of it, about half of it, will go into automation.
Okay. Got it. All right. Thank you. All the best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Amit, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Nikhil, I wanted to understand what are your thoughts on the dividend distribution policy? Because even when you say that you are looking to use the existing cash for the business, we are still generating about even right now 10 to 15 rupees of EPS per year, and expect it to go up. So why are we so stingy in terms of distributing dividend?
I think they've been increasing dividend, Amit, year on year. It's been a steady increase. And it just being a little conservative at this point of time with our capital, because yes, we do have some plans which are yet to fructify, but if they do, we will use, we will make some big investments. And that is the main reason why we have just put a hold on increasing dividends in a big way, or going in for share buybacks at the moment. So this the cash we want to deploy into our business, which will give us the best returns.
Okay, but we've been sitting on an average 150 crores for the last 3-4 years, and we haven't done anything with it. That really depresses our return ratios, and just looks like the organization is not doing particularly well. So even if we were to give some of the money away, and then later on, if we need money for growth, we can always raise capital. So that's not something that you're open to.
That giving it away is, I don't understand that. So we have not to consider this option. Let me put it that way.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ankit Gupta from Bamboo Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity and congratulations for a great year, Nikhil. Nikhil, on the capital allocation part, earlier in our conversations with you over the past many years, you know, we our current existing capacity, we can stretch up to 750-800 crore of revenue with existing facility, and we do have some spare land available at our existing plants as well. So, you know, for the first time, we are hearing about your plans for, you know, capital investment and using the cash on hand for deploying in future expansions, or, you know, some other way, maybe acquisition or something. So if you can, I know you won't be sharing the plans, the detailed plans about, you know, what is the way you'll be using this cash. But, you know, what has prompted you to change this policy? Because earlier we have used cash for buybacks, dividends and all. So what has changed now? And if you can throw some light on this.
So I think really good question. And I think the answer is, that we have really put together a plan for the next 3 to 5 years, you know, which direction that we want to go into, what are the new products that we want to introduce, what are the new markets that we want to get into, what are the new technologies that we need to acquire or need to develop by ourselves. But we have developed a good plan for ourselves. And so we are working on all these areas quite intensively. And if some of them start to fructify in the next year or two, in the next year, I guess, we will start seeing the necessity to start deploying some of the cash into these projects, into these new products. So that is definitely the shift. I've always said that when we come to the stage when our capacities start filling up, we will start looking at the next step of what is to be done next. I've always maintained that. And the first priority always was to fill the existing capacity. So we are definitely put those bricks into place, let me say, you know. So those things are in place. But now we have to think about what is next beyond that. And the thinking has already started some time ago. The plans are getting finalized. And as I said, we have definitely identified specific products and specific markets that we want to get into. And that may need cash for the future, and will need cash for the future. So that's a change in our thinking.
That's good to know. And secondly, on the railways part, you know, we do understand that, you know, this 500-600 crore annual market is highly concentrated with few players. So, you know, over the long term, let's say if we get empaneled with railways, how do you see this business shaping up for us? Like,
what are your expectations of annual revenue from this business?
Yeah, I've mentioned this a number of times before. I said around 10% would be a good starting point for us.
Sure. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Manish Goyal from Enam Holding. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, Nikhil. How are you doing?
Hello, Manish. I'm fine. How are you?
Good, Nikhil. Thanks a lot. Just want to get a perspective on the steam turbine market. You did mention in your initial remarks that a market is quite strong, and also a lot of greenfield plants, steel, cement, sugar, have captive power requirements. So maybe if you can provide some insights as to how is the market, has the inquiry pipeline in volumes grown, would be really helpful.
Vinay, do you want to answer this question?
Steam turbine market has come back, and there are a lot of steel and cement plants are going for expansion, and mainly heat recovery plants are coming up. And after almost 10 years, we are seeing a very good surge in the demand for steam turbine market, and our major customers are really doing well. And this year, we have a very good order book, and we have a very good pipeline of inquiries, and we are seeing a very good year this year for steam turbine business.
So would it be possible to maybe quantify in terms of what was the market last year and inquiry pipeline, and what is it now? And ideally, are you seeing the demand for higher range generators as well?
No, it is not higher range turbines, and higher range turbines are very few, but most of the orders are below 25 megawatts, and mainly in the heat recovery plants. And biomass and waste heat recovery, municipal waste burning, there are a lot of inquiries in the pipeline, and small distilleries as well.
Okay.
No big steam turbines above 30 megawatts.
But is it that from say last couple of years, what a market inquiry pipeline was? Is it that inquiry pipeline is 40-50% up? I do recollect that in peak times in 2011-12, the overall market size used to be 2000 megawatts, which had fallen to some 600-700 megawatts. So if you can put some numbers, it will be
better perspective. Yeah, you can say that it's coming back to the same level of 2011-12.
Okay, wonderful. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Bajrang Bafna from Sunidhi Securities. Please go ahead.
Congratulations for a decent set of numbers for last year. I joined a bit late, so maybe the question can be repetitive. We are already seeing, the commodity prices are spiraling, and few of the players in the competition have indicated that it might have some impact on the margins. So, will be helpful if we could, guide something, because we have been on the 11-12% kind of margin in the last year trajectory. So, what impact it could have on our margins? Because top line, I think you have already guided that 550 plus is doable even in this year, despite some hiccup in the first quarter. But especially on the, passing on the, the inflated prices of commodity, how it will impact, our business. That will be helpful, sir.
Yeah, I think I've spoken extensively on this already. I think you must have missed it. But I'll just try to give a quick summary for your benefit that I've said that we have largely been able to nullify the pending the order that we have on hand with some of the actions that we have taken in the past, like buying raw materials, hedging the exchange, also price variation clauses. And for the rest, what is coming new, we are under discussions with our key customers, and I'm not in a position to tell you exactly what is the impact at this point of time, but we know we are under discussions.
Okay, but for past orders,
there could be some small impact is what I'm saying, because that is, you know, what we're talking about could be 125 crores, could be impacted. So, you know, we need to see how much what could be the impact of 125 crores.
Okay, 125 crores out of the current order book of 475 crores, correct?
No. If 475 we have, now I'm saying another 75 minimum we will do, and we could even go to 600. So the actual listing, we said 550 plus. So we are currently talking to our customers for about 100-125 crores of business on the price impact.
Got it, sir. And on 475, the order book that we are having, that will not be impacted, you know, because we might have, you know, back-to-back arrangements when we got these orders, correct?
No, I have given extensive replies to these unseen questions a little bit earlier, you know, so, I mean, I think...
Okay, I'll go through the whole thing once again. No issues, sir. I'll go through the transcript later. No issues.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
Any other question, Mr. Bhavna?
No. Thanks a lot, ma'am.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nitin S. Dharmawat from Aurum Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. You mentioned that you might be doing some capex in the future. So and you are still under in the discussion mode within the organization. So just wanted to know, you know, what are the areas in which you are evaluating? Will it be a export base or will it be a more domestic kind of opportunity that for that you are planning?
It could be both. It could be export as well as but it's. I would say it's skewed towards the domestic side, definitely.
Got it. And any indication about the size that you are planning in terms of amount involved?
I've not in a position to answer these questions at this moment because.
Got it. No problem.
We need to have some real meat on the bone before we can talk about it.
Got it. I understand. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Kriti Jain from Sundaram Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Congratulations for a very good performance in FY21. We have doubled our operating. Hi, sir. So congratulations, sir. We have doubled our EBITDA in the current year. Good to see, sir. Long persistence, and you have done excellent job, sir. Very good to see, sir. Sir, my first question is, sir, with the Caterpillar, with the railway business, and some of the new business which you are trying to do, directionally, will we be trying to do a business of 1,000 crores in FY24, sir? That would be the broad thing in our mind, sir, back of the mind.
It's 24 is 2-3 years from now.
Yes, sir.
You see, I the question was really why we're not spending our cash. So we're not spending our cash because we want to invest our cash into the business. And we have some plans for investing, plans for new products and new markets, and we are definitely going to be keeping our cash for this opportunity, which is going to be coming up into the future. I think that there will be a time when I will clearly explain to all my investors, all my shareholders, that this is what we plan to do, and this is the growth plan. Once we have got some sure indications that yes, the products are in line with the market expectations, we have the right pricing, we have the, we have been the entry opportunities are becoming real, and once the opportunities become real, we will present them and we will say yes, this is what we plan to do, this is how much business we plan to get, this is how much money we want to invest, and this is how the company is going to grow. So it's a little premature to ask me these questions. I'm sure that I will communicate with all the shareholders
at the appropriate time. And you can be sure that we will be completely open and transparent about our plans for the future. But what we want to really indicate is that we are not in the mode of share buybacks or dividends, because we are planning to invest this money into our business. This is what the basic message we want to get.
Okay. So my question came because in one of the earlier participants' thing, you were told that we have a 3 to 5 year strategy planned for new product, new market, and new geography. That's why I connected these two things and directionally.
It is a very logical question: how much money, how much market, how much business, how much sales? Totally logical questions. These are the first questions that I should be answering once it is clear. But I think I just wanted to highlight to you how this came about, right? This came about from how are you going to allocate the capital? And so my basic point was that we're not going to, capital allocation has been reserved for future products and future growth. Now, what is the future products and future growth? I will inform my shareholders as soon as possible.
Sure, sir. Calendar year, these opportunities should fructify, right, sir?
Yeah, we will keep you posted on earnings call to earnings call.
Sure.
And we are definitely working. But on the opportunities which are fructifying rather quickly, I can say at least which will have an immediate impact is one is that engine business, and the other one is the Indian Railways business. Those we will see faster results, because those are things which they've been working on now already for the past 2 years.
Thanks, sir. Thanks a lot, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Dhiral Shah from Phillip Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, sir, and thanks for the opportunity. Sir, last con call, sir, you talked about that you have bidded for a private train tenders. So have you received any order?
Vinay, that tender is still not been closed, right? But I think it's July, right?
Yeah.
When it's going to close?
July.
Yeah. July is when the tender will close, and then we will know who are the companies which have won those bids. I think two or three companies have bid right now: GMR plus another two. And once those companies win, they will start ordering the locomotives. Then the company that wins the locomotive order, hopefully it is our customer. And then if it is our customer, then yes, we will get that business.
Okay. And sir, you have talked about that there will be a 10% growth in railway business for FY22, right? So how much we did in FY21 railway business?
Our asking, how much did we do in railway business last year? 60, right?
Yes, sir.
60%. And
10%. It's going to go from 60 crores to 100 crores.
100.
This year, sir?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. That's it from my side.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rajesh Kumar, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon and congratulations on a good set of numbers.
Thank you, Rajesh.
Hope you, your family and your staff are safe and secure in the current pandemic situation.
Yes, yeah, thank you. I hope the same for you.
I have two questions. One is about the engine business. Since for the pre-concourse, you had been mentioning about a few different customers, so I just wanted to connect some dots there. The first is, the Caterpillar is the company where we have supplied some 8 engines or so in the last year, and that is where the approval has happened, and we were to replace the current supplier over a period of 2 years. Is that the correct understanding?
You know, I don't specifically discuss customer names on conference calls, but I won't deny that, yes.
No, I'm not asking the customer name. What I was trying to say is, this is one customer where we have done all this process and where we were going to replace the existing supplier.
Yes.
Okay. The second about the engine, so you know, the other, there were a few more, like we had supplied some 9 megawatt, 9 numbers to deep desalination barge. And you had talked of some other engine customers based out of Austria, Germany. So they're all different other than what you have got to order.
Yes.
Okay, sir. And my second question is about the order book. As per the investor presentation, it is mentioned 410 crore if I remove the railways order. And now you are saying as on date it is around 475 crores. So that means in the current almost 2 months we have received an additional 65 crores orders for the current financial. Is this correct, Vakram?
475 crores is the executable order for this on hand right now, including the railway business.
Including the railway business. But in the investor presentation, we have 410 crores plus railway order which has been given.
Yeah, so it's a combination of some part of the generator business, some part of the railway business, some part of the Turkey business. I'm sorry, Turkey business is not in this 475. It's some part of the generator business and some part of the railway business. Put together, what we're telling you is that there are some things that go on hold, some things that go on cancellation, or et cetera. Not cancellation, but really on hold. So the number that we have on hand for execution as of date today is 475 crores for this financial year.
Okay. Okay. Thank you very much, and all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ravindranath Naik from Sunidhi Securities. Please go ahead.
Hello. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Hello.
You are audible, Mr.
Yes,
Knight.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
There's a background disturbance, so I would request you to mute yourself while the management is answering your question. You may proceed with your question, please.
Okay. Thank you for the opportunity, and congratulations for a good set of numbers. Sir, I have actually, you mentioned that 50% of revenue that you booked for railways, it is for your part or including the Alstom's part?
So this 15 machines what I've mentioned is not, this is directly with the Indian Railways.
Okay, okay. So Alstom would be another 90 or 100 crores?
The Alstom business is separate, that is 100 crores. This is only 15, this is not a big value. Yeah.
Okay, so including Alstom, we got the revenue of 100 to 160 crores this year in FY 2021, right, sir?
No,
in FY 21
crores
we had 60 crores in FY 21, and in FY 22 it will be 100 crores. Alstom business.
Okay. Sir, is it possible to give a bifurcation of the order book in terms of turbine, engine, locomotive, and special application front for the revenue and the order book? Is it possible to bifurcate?
It is possible, but we don't want to do that.
Okay. But one thing, across all the segments, the margin is quite similar, or it is different from different segments, like turbine is separate, different margin, engine is different margin, considering the scope of the work. So whether it is similar or it is different?
It is different from product to product. For sure, but overall, okay. It is not that much different.
Okay, got it. Sir, this quarter we have a write back of 36 lakhs due to some CNR interest provision. So, what is the recurring cost of interest cost in this quarter?
Parlashi, can you answer that question?
Can you come back on your question, sir, please?
36 lakh is the right debt of the interest. So, what is the interest cost recurring for this quarter?
No, actually, what happened is that we have an FCNR loan and we have to reinstate it at the end of each quarter. So, in December, the euro was at 89 versus in March it was at 86. So, the differential we had to take it back. That's why the negative has come.
Thank you. I would request Mr. Knight to rejoin the queue. The next question is from the line of Adit Shah from Vibrant Securities. Please go ahead.
Hi, Nikhil. I have two questions. Number one is that if I look at the OPEX, I think it has increased significantly sequentially to around 38 crores quarterly, which was around 32 odd crores. So have we given sort of hikes to employees? And should we assume this number to continue going forward? And number two is that in this year, we had fairly strong gross margins. And of course, you have explained about the scenario currently with respect to the commodities and your customer competitions. But do you want to hazard a guess about your gross margin for next year? How much pressure can we see in terms of numbers? That would be helpful.
Can you explain this 6 crore difference on? I don't think this is going to be the run rate for
Yeah, there has been some small inflationary increases on the salary which has been given to all the employees. Some portion is coming from there, and some portion is also coming from the exchange loss what we had, which is just reported in the books. We don't have the actual loss on the actual loss in terms of cash, but it's only the accounting entry which has brought in that number.
What is that number, ma'am?
It's around 2.5 crores.
Okay, in this quarter itself. Okay.
Yeah.
Got it. So should I assume that? Should I remove that number to understand the steady state OPEX rate?
So you're not audible clearly, sir.
Hello, is it better now?
No.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
So should I move the 2.5 crores to understand the steady state OPEX?
Is that correct?
Got it.
Yes.
So around 35 crores should be the steady state number on a quarterly basis. And second question is, Nikhil, we have been working very hard to structurally improve the gross margin profile of the business. Historically, the numbers tell that we were doing as low as 26%. Today we are doing, I think this year, close to 33% odd. So just two questions. Number one, in the near term, we know that there is a pressure and this the gross margins could be under pressure for the current year. But over the long term, do you want to comment about the initiatives which you are taking? And is it possible for the gross margins of the company to structurally improve to say 35% odd levels on a sustainable basis?
Yeah, it is really unfortunate that we have a setback this year because of raw material price. Because we were on that trajectory to move to 35% gross margin. That was really the plan based on price increases and price variation clauses and all this action that we have taken to increase the gross margin now are going to offset the raw material price increase. This is really unfortunate from the company's point of view. Of course, it is what it is. At least we've had those cushions built in, and we are using those cushions that we have had. Now, the big question is, what is going to be the gross contribution for this financial year? And I will be able to answer that question only after I finish the various negotiations, and we also see some level of stability or certainty coming on the raw material prices for the rest of the year. So I think I've given enough of hints as to what is impacted, what is not impacted, and we will do our best to control it and keep it within that we don't have a severe impact within on the margins of the organization. Of course, that is our goal, and that's what we're going to achieve.
Got it. Can I push in one last question?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah. The last question is, the guidance has not changed materially. It's been pretty much same with respect to last quarter. While we have done some breakthrough developments with a couple of customers, as you have announced in the current con call. So does it mean that a lot of the business will not come, any of the business will not come in this year and will come in the next year? Or have we lost out on some of the other business? Like, I think the railways, you were saying 110 crores in last, I believe, which has, I think, come down to 100 crores. So I think, is it that we have lost 10 crores because of COVID? And so just want to understand two things. One, are we being conservative in the guidance? Or is it that some of the incremental revenues from new customers has been offset by the losses in domestic market due to the COVID situation?
So we have not lost any business. Like, for example, Alstom 110 has become 100. It is that they have revised their demand based on the number of locomotives that they're going to produce. So we're not lost anything. There is a big flux in the market right now with the raw material prices going so high that there is definitely a situation where a lot of things are under negotiation. So we with right. our OEM customers with our end users, because nobody can take such a huge impact for a long period of time. You know, this is such a, you know, steel prices are double, for example. It's not possible.
Right.
So we have not been overly optimistic in giving a very rosy picture on the top line, because we just want to see how this thing pans out. There's a lot of, as Vinay has also said, there's a lot of business in the pipeline. And I've also seen a lot of business in the pipeline. There's no, it's really a tragic situation that we have so much business in the pipeline that, you know, and unfortunately we are in this situation where we have this crazy increases of raw material prices. It would have, you know, okay, but let's not talk about hypothetically what it is what it is right now. So we have to navigate our way through this, and we are on the way to do it. As I said, our philosophy would be to keep our customer relationships, to keep the business intact, because this storm will pass. You know, this raw material price increases today, if today is like this, and tomorrow, if you have 1 month or 2 months more of inflation, and then you have, let's say, for example, Federal Reserve starts talking about increasing interest rates, this whole bubble will pop. And then we don't want to be sitting on the other side of the fence with our customers when the bubble pops, the raw material prices come back to some level of normalcy, and then we are saying that, you know, we don't have any orders. So we have to carefully navigate our way through this situation, and that's why we are not being overly optimistic about the projections. It is a extremely unusual situation that we are all of us are in right now. So there's a certain level of caution that we're building in our commentary with you.
Sure, Nikhil. Thank you. All the best.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, was our question for today. Members of the management, you may go ahead with your closing comments.
Thank you very much for joining us on this call, and we look forward to interacting with you at the end of next quarter once again. Thank you.
Thank you. On behalf of TD Power Systems Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.